The approach phase of any flight is one of the most demanding periods on crews while operating the aircraft. Crews must maneuver the aircraft into position to approach the runway, while configuring the aircraft for landing and managing its energy, communicating with air traffic control, and maintaining situational awareness in regards to their aircraft and its performance, other aircraft, weather conditions, and anticipating how all of these will change over time. In the multi-crew environment on the flight deck of large commercial aircraft, both the pilot flying and pilot monitoring work together to ensure a safe and stable approach. Sometimes, however, approaches become destabilized. Today, we'll be taking a look at unstable approaches, characteristics, and avoidance. The Flight Safety Foundation lists some of the factors that may lead to an unstabilized approach, including fatigue, pressure of flight and crew schedules, any crew-induced or ATC-induced circumstances resulting in insufficient time to plan, prepare, and conduct a safe approach, ATC instructions that result in flying too high, too fast, or result in shorter than expected routings to and during the final approach, inadequate energy management, excessive head-down work, for example, flight management system reprogramming late in the approach, inadequate awareness of wind conditions, including tailwind component, low altitude wind shear, or recent weather along the final approach path, and excessive confidence that the crew and aircraft will achieve stabilization by the minimum stabilization height. The Flight Safety Foundation Approach and Landing Accident Reduction Task Force found that unstable approaches were a causal factor in 66% of 76 approach and landing accidents and serious incidents worldwide in 1984 through 1997. High-speed approaches can result in the loss of aircraft control, runway overruns, and runway excursions. Flight handling difficulties, or the crew's inability to control the aircraft to the desired flight parameters, was found to be a causal factor in 45% of approach and landing accidents and serious incidents. What constitutes an unstable approach? One or more of the following deviations are often involved in unstabilized approaches. Steep approach, above desired flight path with excessive vertical speed, or entire approach flown at idle thrust due to an excessively steep approach. Shallow approach, below desired glide path. Excessive airspeed or low airspeed maneuvering, or energy deficit. Excessive bank angle when capturing the final approach course, or not aligned with the runway. Activation of the ground proximity warning system, or the terrain awareness and warning system.
Sink rate, too low, flaps.
Late extension of flaps, or flaps load relief system activation resulting in the late extension of flaps. Speed brakes remain extended on short final approach. High at runway threshold crossing, i.e. more than 50 feet above the threshold, and extended flare and extended touchdown. The FAA defines a stable approach as follows. A pilot is flying a stabilized approach when they establish and maintain a constant angle glide path towards a predetermined point on the landing runway. The origins of a stable approach begin well in advance of the commencement of the approach, during the approach brief. There's lots to talk about in terms of briefs, so we'll revisit the specifics another time. For our purposes, the brief allows pilots to plan their approach and discuss threats and mitigation strategies. The following are the recommended elements of a stabilized approach. It is recommended that all flights be stabilized by 1,000 feet above airport elevation in instrument meteorological conditions, and by 500 feet above airport elevation in visual meteorological conditions. Keep in mind that each aircraft type and each aircraft operator will have slightly different criteria and specifics, but most lists will be similar to the following. The aircraft is on the correct flight path, and its corollary, only small changes in heading and pitch are required to maintain the correct flight path. The aircraft speed is not more than VREF plus 20 knots indicated airspeed, and not less than VREF. Deviations of plus 10 or minus 5 knots relative to VREF are acceptable if the airspeed is trending towards VREF. The aircraft is in the correct landing configuration. This includes flap set in the planned landing configuration, landing gear down and locked, speed brakes or spoilers armed, and any other aircraft-specific configuration requirements. Sink rate is no greater than 1,000 feet per minute. If an approach requires a sink rate greater than 1,000 feet per minute, a special briefing should be conducted. Power setting is appropriate for the aircraft's configuration and is not below the minimum power for approach as defined by the aircraft's operating manual. For most commercial aircraft, the increased drag that comes with landing flap extension and landing gear will increase the required thrust to maintain airspeed on final. All briefings and checklists have been conducted, and unique approach procedures or abnormal conditions requiring a deviation from the aforementioned criteria require a special briefing. Specific types of approaches are stabilized if they also fulfill the following. Instrument landing system, ILS approaches, must be flown within one dot of the glide slope and localizer. A Category 2 or Category 3 ILS approach must be flown within the expanded localizer band. And during a circling approach, wings should be level on final when the aircraft reaches 300 feet above airport elevation. Positive corrective actions should be taken before deviations develop into a challenging or hazardous situation in which the only safe action is a go-around. Corrective actions may include the timely use of speed brakes or landing gear to correct excessive height or excessive airspeed, and extending the outbound leg or downwind leg. Should any of these conditions not be met at the approach gate, most operators require crew to initiate a go-around. The Flight Safety Foundation recommends that no fault or no blame go-around policies be implemented by operators, supported by management and reinforced by training systems. If you're interested in learning more about stabilized approaches, check the link in the description for the excellent briefing note from the Flight Safety Foundation, as well as for resources from ICAO and the FAA. Thanks for watching, and let me know in the comments what topics you'd like me to cover next.